Hey everybody, Tim Evanicki here with the College Audition, back again with another episode of the College Audition podcast. My name is Tim Evanicki, and I'm here with my special guest, Gary Kline, teaching professor of voice, assistant option coordinator of acting and music theater at Carnegie Mellon University. Thanks so much for joining us, Gary.
Oh, so glad to be here, Tim. Finally.
I know we've been bouncing around this podcast for over a year now, and we finally get an opportunity to sit down with each other. So first, we always like to get to know the person before the program. So if you could, please give us a little bit of your background, your training and career that led you up to your time at Carnegie Mellon.
Well, I like to say that I'm a graduate of the School of Hard Knocks. I started out thinking that I wanted to be an opera singer, and my major was vocal performance, and it was Dana School of Music in Youngstown State. And not recognizing that the field of opera takes many, many years, I thought I should be a star at 21, and I wasn't. And I was quite upset about that. And I had worked my voice into some kind of a very heavy bass baritone, which probably a tenor. It's an interesting journey as a singer, because I think most musical theater performers do concentrate on the voice, maybe not as much on acting. But I went to, in between hiatus, which I eventually graduated from the Carnegie Mellon music program. But in between that, I studied with a wonderful opera singer named Patricia Kern in Toronto, and on my own, drove from Pittsburgh to Toronto for 5 years and took these amazing voice lessons, which informed my teaching so much. She was an amazing teacher. I studied acting at the Stanford University at the British American Drama Academy, and I met great actors there, Marsha Mason, Ed Asner, Eli Wallach, Ann Jackson. I was able to study with amazing people there. I went to the Cabaret Symposium in the O'Neill Theater in Connecticut. I studied at Paul Gimignani's school in New York City. I guess all to say that I wanted to know how singing and acting combined. And I didn't want to be just a singing teacher. I really wanted to know how to teach acting, be an actor, understand where that comes from. So all of that, plus the degrees, which whoop-de-doo, from Dana School of Music and Carnegie Mellon, all of that has helped me round out my education and help me become the teacher that I think I am today.
And how did it come to pass that you ended up in your position today?
Well, that's interesting, because I owe it all to the great students that I taught. They had at Carnegie Mellon back in that day, because I'm, you know, a man of a certain age. Carnegie Mellon was one of the first musical theater programs. And of course, everybody up to that point had studied either acting or music. And musical theater started to become very popular in the 80s, early 80s. So I, as a graduate student at Carnegie Mellon, they asked me to teach voice lessons. And they had recycled through a lot of graduate teachers. So, graduate students, I should say. And when it came my turn to leave, the students kind of went en masse to the head of the School of Drama at that time, Liz Orion, and said, "We are not going to accept another grad student. We want Gary Kline to stay." And I was shocked. I was called in, and with her bracelets jangling, Liz Orion said, "Gary, the students seem very fond of you and want you to continue teaching them." And so I was offered a paltry little amount of money to teach these students, and which, by the way, included the great Renee Elise Goldsberry and Donalyn Champlin and several others from that class that I can't remember. But I accepted the position and realized that there was no real musical theater program there. It was just singing and dance, really. It was added on to the acting curriculum. And so from there, I was able to start developing a program, which I'm very proud of today. But that's how I started at Carnegie Mellon, through the students insisting that I stay their teacher.
That's I've not heard that story before. That's incredible. Tell us, it goes without question that Carnegie Mellon is one of the most sought after programs in the country. I think that every student that is looking at a major in musical theater probably does their research on Carnegie Mellon. Tell us what you, in your words, why you believe that Carnegie Mellon sort of holds that place of honor now amongst other programs.
I think the main reason, perhaps, is that we honor acting first. Carnegie Mellon has always been a classical acting training program. Started in, 1914, I think. It's the oldest acting conservatory in the country. And so it was acting. And then when they brought in the musical theater part of it, the musical theater was basically like a really bad stepchild that irritated a lot of the serious actors. And but through the great success of these students, who knew how to act, do leading roles as an actor, but could also sing really, really well, it gained great respect. And I think that's really the unique part of Carnegie Mellon, is that you will be trained as an actor. You will take all the classes that an actor takes, plus you will take the musical theater courses, which, by the way, at this point, the courses, of course, are singing, musical theater skills, which is basically theory, a cabaret class that I teach, dance, of course, many different kinds of dance, musical theater lit and rep. There's an audition class, and there's also an acting a song class, which I teach. So all of those classes are on top of all your basic acting, movement, voice, and speech classes that the actors take.
And when I introduced you, you have a mouthful of a title, sir. Assistant Option Coordinator of Acting and Music Theater. Tell us what that role entails. What is your job other than the teaching?
Well, my job is to make sure that this musical theater program stays at the top of its game. I honestly don't understand that title, because I do not have anything really to do with the actors as such. I don't teach them, although I did at one point in my career. however, now my goal is to make sure that we have great connections in the world of musical theater. Maybe I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but one of the ways that I do that is through my cabaret class, for instance. I had started this, I think, 12 years ago, and I'm bringing in currently these great composers that connect with the School of Drama. The composers perform with my students. They, except in COVID, which we had to do, sadly, something online on Zoom, the Zoom cabaret, we had to film it. And that was with the great Janine Tesori, who came in and coached again on Zoom. But I've had great guests in Stephen Flaherty, David Yazbek, Maltby and Shire, Andrew Lippa, Stephen Schwartz is coming in this fall. And so that I feel is part of my job, is to stay, to keep our program connected with the best in the business. And then I'd also have to say our alum keep it current too, because they keep coming back and helping us teach and keeping us connected to the business as well. Another great thing that we offer is, of course, a showcase, which the seniors go to New York City and LA. They fly to both cities and do a showcase of their talent with a serious bend on singing and also acting. It's not just a late little song and dance thing. Every musical theater student does an acting scene. So these are the things that I think I've helped continue on our journey of excellence in musical theater, which is my passion. I appreciate my acting colleagues very much, but also connect with Pittsburgh Civic Light Opera, the third largest theater in the United States. It's right here in Pittsburgh, and they hire many of our students. We do a new works project with them. So I've connected our Carnegie Mellon with Civic Light Opera as well, because it's important that we move outside of our school and don't stay in a very small little pod. I think it's really important. So hopefully that's answering your question.
So those of us who follow news closely about Carnegie Mellon and other top programs in the country may have recently heard that there is a new face coming in as the head of the School of Drama. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. Sadly, we lost a wonderful head of the School of Drama, Peter Cook, I think 3 years ago he left. And the school has been in, quite frankly, a little bit of disarray, which is normal. That's just the way it is. I think in those 3 years, we've had perhaps five different interim heads. And it's really time to get someone on board that's going to be our fearless leader. And Robert Ramirez is a person that I've only met once in a small group, but I kind of love who he is, just from first blush, as they say. I'm excited to have a new head that will lead us and really unite us, I hope, into a real strong program, which we already are. But it's still good to have a head because we need that and a steady hand for a long time, which mm-hmm. really helps. It's the history that we need behind us, and I think Robert's going to do that for us. I'm really excited to have him on board.
Great. Well, we're excited to meet him and get to know him a bit more. He's coming from UT, right?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah. Awesome. So let's switch gears now and start diving into the program a bit more and talking about the opportunities there. You mentioned that you had listened to an episode before meeting with us today, so you'll know that I put my guests on the spot a little bit and ask them for a 60-second elevator pitch before we get into anything else on the program. I say 60 seconds. I think maybe one guest in the last year has actually kept it under 60 seconds. But give us sort of an overview as to why students should be considering Carnegie Mellon.
I think you should consider Carnegie Mellon because you get singing lessons, private singing lessons, all 4 years. You also get a private coaching with a pianist that takes care of that. We have dance, three amazing dance teachers, which revolve around Afrocentric dance, ballet, jazz, Broadway styles, you name it. You will stay connected, even though we're not a dance program. We have great dance. And most of all, the acting program is taught by great acting professors who will challenge you to delve into a text. You will learn classical literature, which I think is important. It's history. We need to know that. You also perform with some of the greatest composers of all time, which I've already told you about. And in general, the great city of Pittsburgh, you will love. And the campus is beautiful. And you will love the conservatory training if you have the discipline.
Mm. Gary, I'm glad that was well under 60 seconds. Well done, sir. I'm glad you actually brought up dance right in the beginning there, because one of the misconceptions that I hear regularly from students that are coming to me for the first time is that Carnegie Mellon does not put an emphasis on dance. And that might have to do with the fact that until, I believe, this year, you never included dance as part of the audition process. But can you talk a little bit more about the dance program?
Sure. We actually did have a dance audition portion for many years. And we found that really what our emphasis on in Carnegie Mellon is the actor and the singer. And we really would love them to dance, but we have two different levels of dance. So when they come in, if you're not an accomplished dancer, you can choose to take, well, you'll actually be put into different sections of dance where you fit best and where you can succeed. It's just amazing. The students that have, the great dancers that have come into our school stay great dancers and improve. They, by all accounts, they are very happy with the dance training. And those that can't dance at all, I think of Christian Borrell, for instance, who really couldn't dance. And he, when he left, his first role was a national tour of Riff in West Side Story. So he was able to do that dance, and he loves to tell that story, he himself, because he says, you know, I learned all my dance at Carnegie Mellon. I was able to dance when I left. And while it's not an emphasis, it is certainly a strong part of our training.
Mm-hmm. So let's imagine that I am a freshman musical theater student headed to my first year at CMU. What does my schedule look like that first year?
Oh, it's horrible. It's just awful. No, seriously, I just, you know, it's, you have to have a discipline to come to Carnegie Mellon. If you want to dally around in fraternities and parties and that kind of thing, where you just want to have a big social life, it may not be the school for you, because it is a conservatory. And there are so many classes that you need to keep moving forward in. Lots of technique in the first year. In fact, I would say the first year is really about technique. It's about building a foundation for your career. It's technical things that some students will, I just want to perform. I just want to sing. I just want to act. But they don't know how to sing. They don't know how to act. And they don't understand the basic concepts of the techniques that are needed, which is why we ask you not to go on stage. We just don't give you an opportunity to go on stage in the freshman year, because you'll just reinforce your bad habits. You need to take time off stage and just give yourself a chance to study, to learn, and to absorb. And yes, you can still audition for shows and things outside of CMU, for the summer work, etc. But my God, y'all need technique. Y'all need technique. You cannot survive this without knowing how to do the craft. And that is terribly important, which is why that first year, it's tough, because you are learning a lot of technique and a lot of craft. And I think it's worth it. I think it's worth it, because then it buds into something fabulous in the later years.
I couldn't agree more. I tell students all the time that say, oh, well, I want to be able to perform my freshman year. And I say, why? Because you're setting yourself up for your future career, which will hopefully last longer than your 4 years in college. So it's good to take the time now. And it's certainly the way that I was trained at Juilliard, and it's worth it. So what about gen ed classes? Tell us what students study outside of singing, dancing, and acting.
Well, for musical theater, it's quite simple. There's quantitative reasoning in the junior year, which I don't know what that is.
It's okay. And you're still relatively new there, Gary. That's all right.
I'm also blonde, you know. There is, of course, world history, English, and computer skills. And that is about it. If you want to take other things, you have to do those on your own, which students have done. I've had musical theater young man on a national tour of To Kill a Mockingbird. He got a minor in business. But it takes extraordinary effort to do that. It's something that is not easily worked into the schedule, but if you have the discipline, you can absolutely do it. The actors are required, if you're in the acting program, they're required to take 7 electives outside of the School of Drama. But the musical theater students simply don't have the time because of all the extra classes.
I always ask if, I always say that there's a difference between possible and probable when you're talking about a minor or studying other things. So you're saying it is possible, but not always probable based on your schedule.
That's it. Absolutely, yeah. Tim. That's right.
So let's go back to the performance opportunities. You said that freshmen are not given opportunities their first year, but tell us in general what is being produced at the School of Drama each year.
Well, first, let me interject that we do have this one performance opportunity for everyone, freshmen through seniors. Excuse me. It's called Playground, and the classes are canceled for an entire week. One time I think we canceled 2 weeks, and students are encouraged to do they're encouraged to do their own projects, their own plays, their own musicals, and they're given support from the school, and we shut down the school, and they work for the first 5 days and then perform the following 3 days. It's quite a unique thing, and it's quite exciting. And a lot of freshmen, sophomores, everyone joins in and performs in that. We also have in the junior year, we have a JPP, which is a junior performance project. And that it just includes either a play or a musical directed by a faculty. This fall, I think we're doing Spelling Bee, which is kind of crazy and fun because we don't do enough comedy, God knows. pardon me. And we do a main stage musical. We have a fabulous, fabulous theater. It's called the Chosky Theater. 450 seats, state of the art, everything that you would ever want in a theater. We produce 22 productions a year. Oh my God, that's so much work to do 22 productions. Everything is built in-house, design, costumes, lighting. There's majors in everything that supports these 22 productions. We're trying to do a few less, I think, because it's a lot. But musical theater, students are cast in plays often. It's quite an amalgamation of productions. We have a playwriting program, and the students, musical theater as well, perform in those new plays. I think that's really important to do this new work. There's a lot of performance opportunities, especially as you enter your junior and senior years. You will be busy.
Are there student-led productions as well, or are all 22 of those produced by the school?
They're produced by the school, but we have an undergraduate directing program, and all the undergraduate directors are given a play, a musical if they wish. We've had undergrads do musicals. So they are directing. We also have a graduate directing program, and those graduate directors are also directing students. So it is definitely not all faculty led. In fact, most of it is not. I would say most of it is not. It is directed by students, for the students, with faculty advisors. That's kind of exciting and cool. And then we bring in lovely guest directors as well to come in, and which is kind of nice to make that outside connection.
Right. I usually ask for a list of notable alum or faculty, but in this case, I'll just say we can probably Google it because Carnegie Mellon has quite an extensive list. But I do know that you regularly bring back alum to do workshops and with current students. So can you tell us some of the highlights of some recent visits that you've had there?
Well, COVID was really tricky on us, wasn't it? But I was happy to bring in so many beautiful people on the Zoom and then some in person. Billy Porter came back often in person when I would just invite him. He was in town for something. I said, Billy, come into a master class, which he would. He would come in and hold a class just challenge the students like crazy. Oh, he's fun. Mm-hmm. Patrick Wilson comes back often, and his wife, Dagmara Demenchik, is also an actress. And they come in and do projects. Patrick came back and directed The Full Monty. Patina Miller came back and did a wonderful Zoom master class. Michael McElroy, who's now head of Michigan, is a great friend. Corey Cott is always kind to do classes for us. Danae Benton has come back. Renee Elise Goldsberry has come back to do classes. They're just brilliant. And they get more respect, as you could imagine, because they're doing it now. The faculty can become old hat, right? Well, Gary says this, blah, blah, Tony says this. But if Patrick says it, or Christian Borrell says it, or Patina says it, okay, all right, mm-hmm. Yes, they know what they're talking about. It's the same thing often, but it doesn't matter.
Exactly.
But so proud of our alum who have been great, great representation for us in the professional world. We're very, very, very lucky to have that legacy. Mm-hmm.
Tell us about some of the other key faculty members that students will interact with during their time there.
Oh, gosh. That's so tricky. I don't know who to put up because everyone is just, I don't know if we have any superstars as such. We're a faculty of people who teach craft and teach basics. And I think of, you know, my friend Tony McKay, who's taught acting there forever. Wonderful teacher. Barbara McKenzie Wood has been a great, great faculty member for so long. We have movement people, Catherine Moore. I'm not sure their household names, Kath Warman. We have lots of voice and speech people, Don Wadsworth, Lisa Velton Smith. Again, I'm not sure these names mm-hmm. mean anything, but they're fabulous teachers who are committed. In fact, I would say all of our faculty have huge commitments to these students of ours.
Yeah, we've been fortunate enough around here to have Barbara and Kyle Hayden and Rick Ettinger teach workshops for us regularly. Rick comes down and does our conservatory every summer.
Oh, yes.
Barbara's taught several master classes for us during the pandemic online. She was a savior. So we love the faculty there and are always looking for ways to reach out and work with more of them.
Oh, great. Yeah, Rick has been a great addition to our musical theater program, by the way. Rick Ettinger. Yeah, really happy to have him.
So you mentioned the showcase, Bicoastal Showcase. Tell us a little bit more about Showcase and what Carnegie Mellon does to sort of kick the students out the door into the real world.
I like that. We're kicking them out. Yes, you're kicked out. And sometimes they don't want to go. They just get really used to this little cocoon of study. But we're, of course, preparing them in all their 4 years for this one moment. And it's a short moment. The song may be, 90 seconds? The scene may be 2 minutes. That's it. But during those short times, you can really show a lot of who you are, which is so important. No one really cares to see you act a character. The accents are generally discouraged. We don't do classical rep in the showcase. We try to show who you are, what you're made of, what your voice does in a natural setting, how you communicate. By the way, we do film our showcase as well, and the beautiful, beautiful production film-wise. And that's a result of the pandemic, which is something we're continuing because people really want to see the reels now, the film. But it's so important, just like when you're going to audition, you want to show who you are. And when you leave, it's the same thing. You've got to show who you are. And that seems so simplistic and so stupid to say, but it's so true. What makes you unique? What are your strengths? How can you show some humanity in your work? Not technique. That technique should be a muscle memory at this point. You need to be able to really set it aside, knowing it's going to stay with you the rest of your life, and produce something of beauty, of love, of value, of warmth. And my dear friend Felicia Rashad always says, your humanity is your greatest gift. And I would say that's so true. That's so true in Showcase. So it's a very short exercise, but it is seamless. It goes from one scene to one song. It's incredibly beautiful. And I would say 90 to 100% of students actually sign with a manager or an agent when they leave. We've had, Casey Cott got Riverdale right out of Showcase. That's happened before. Megan Hilty got Wicked right out of there. It's really kind of cool that it can lead to directly to a career. And then other students wait a very long time, and that's okay too. Success is not instantaneous for everyone. So you've got to be patient and take your time and know that good things will happen if you don't give up. That's my feeling.
Exactly. Tell us a little bit about campus life and the area where Carnegie Mellon is. It's in Pittsburgh, but it's not directly downtown. So tell us what life is like there.
Oh, it's a gorgeous campus. It's in the Oakland section of Pittsburgh, which is very near Shadyside and Squirrel Hill. And it is a beautiful city. If you're thinking Pittsburgh is a smoky old town, you couldn't be more wrong. It is, it's a stunning campus. There are beautiful, beautiful facilities, including a brand new gym, which our students do like to work out and stay in shape. There's a new university center, lots of great eating opportunities there on campus. There's a dormitory that's lovely, but once you finish your freshman year in the dormitory, you're, of course, most, I think everyone moves off campus into these beautiful surrounding communities. It's very safe and it's lovely. It's tree filled. There's also great theater in Pittsburgh, wonderful ballet, wonderful symphony, wonderful opera company. If you can go out and enjoy the city itself and other performance opportunities, it's beautiful.
So let's now transition into the last section here, my last set of questions, which is probably the reason why most students are listening to this podcast, and that is the audition process. So just to start with, an obvious question, but do you pre-screen?
Yes, we do.
And how many pre-screens are you actually receiving each year?
Well, I'm going to include acting in this, and I'll tell you why. Once, when you audition for musical theater, you're also and automatically auditioning for acting, because the acting and the musical theater people are seeing, the acting people are seeing all musical theater and all acting. So you're automatically auditioning for the entire program. So we receive about 1,800, maybe 2,000 with the acting and musical theater combined. It's mm-hmm. It's a lot. It's a lot of pre-screens.
It is. And tell us, what is the process of going through those pre-screens? How many sets of eyes see them? What's the sign-off process to get passed on to the next round?
Well, for the musical theater specifically, we look at the first batch, and there may be 1,200 to 1,400 musical theater pre-screens. But we look at them, and two people have to look before we eliminate, which I really like. We will look and we will add comments. We will score, of course, and those that do not score high enough are immediately eliminated. So perhaps we come down to, let's say, 300. That's just a round number, and it's at that point that we want to see them. And we see them all 300 on a Zoom call. Mm-hmm. And this year, all three of us, Rick, Claudia, my colleague, Claudia Benek, and myself, we watched them all together. It took, I think, 6 days. It was really mm-hmm. a long process. And no acting people see the musical theater until we select those that we think belong, that could have a shot at the acting and musical theater. Then we send them on to the actors. Then the actors look at them, and we keep eliminating. It's a process where it just keeps whittling down until we come up with, I would say, I don't know, 30, 40. It's hard to tell mm-hmm. because every year it's different. It could be as many as 50. But it's a long process, but we really take it seriously. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we just keep running you through.
So you have 2,000 pre-screens. You said you get about 300 to a live audition, approximately?
Yeah, for musical theater, yes.
For musical theater. And they could get a redirect to acting during that as well.
They will if we're serious about them. We come down to the final cut. We then send them to the actors. Mm-hmm. They look at them. They decide from the monologues that are submitted who should be selected, and quite frankly, we have a great deal of influence on that because we really do care about the singing audition. Mm-hmm. And then when we get to the final small group, then they do what we call a dance, or I think they're calling it a movement audition now, a movement call, and they are then seen by my colleague Tomei Cousin, and he will then look at them and judge whether they are able to come into the elementary dance classes or more skilled dance classes.
You were exclusively on Zoom this year, again, for auditions. Is that going to continue, or are you going back to live in person?
I hope back to live in person. I think we'd made the right decision because actually it turned out that there was a big uptick in COVID where a lot of schools had to kind of backtrack from the live auditions. It was really sad and it's very painful. But I think we will be leaving that behind very soon. And I think it's great to breathe the same air, to hear the actual vibration of the voice in the room. It's so different than watching a film, because a film you can't change. And often you're singing to pre-recorded music, which is really tough to be spontaneous and in the moment. Mm-hmm.
So when we do return back to live auditions, other than an on-campus audition, where do you hold your auditions?
Well, we used to travel the United States like crazy, Houston, Atlanta, blah, blah. Now we've kept it to New York, Chicago, and LA, and then Pittsburgh, of course.
So the Unifieds.
Yes, basically the Unifieds. Yep. That's exactly right.
How many offers are you making from that last round? How many offers do you make for incoming students?
Well, this year we offered 12 MTs and 12 actors spots. But this is the value of a wait list, because the students sometimes say, well, I wasn't the first choice. Well, you don't understand what that involves, being a first choice. And when you're on a wait list, you're not a second choice. We actually say you are viable for this program. You would not be on the wait list if you were not. And do not take that as an insult. I would say to any school, we can only accept so many. So if you're on a wait list, congratulations. That means the school thinks you're viable and valuable, and they want to admit you if they can. And this year, we've gone to our wait list. That's fantastic. And the people that we're getting from our wait list are fabulous. It's just, there's so many good people out there. So just hang on. If you really want to get into the school of your choice, don't feel rejected because you're on the wait list. I will tell you that. Please don't.
How far into the wait list did you have to go this year?
Well, there's still offers out, believe it or not, at this point where we're doing this. We did accept, the number. Who knows? We have actually a director of admissions who does all this this point. I used to do it, but I don't do it anymore. But I think we've admitted three from the wait list at this point.
That's wonderful. Is the 12 offers or the 12 spots in your program, are those broken down by demographics in any way?
No. No, and people always think, well, if I audition early, if I audition late, if I do this or I do that, or if I wear a jewel-colored dress, if I do this, none of that helps. None of that helps. It's all about something unique, and you've got to show something, and it's horribly difficult to do this on a camera, isn't it? Don't you find that, Tim? See someone and say, I'm going to take you from this pre-recorded thing. Which is why the live, even though it's on Zoom, it's still live. And that's why that's so important.
Right. And is there any longer a breakdown by gender?
Yes, we do. We really do try to bring in a balanced class, because musicals require male, female. So we generally it's even. Split six and six, six males, six females identifying people. And that's basically where we start from.
Great. And so how would you tackle a non-binary student that is auditioning for you? Like where does that fit in?
It doesn't, again, that won't matter with this, because we realize that this gender thing is fluid, and it it has to be about the talent in the end. It can't be about anything but talent. No matter what pronouns, no matter what, how you identify, it is all about the talent and what you can show on that crazy little audition time that you have. That will get you to where you want to be.
Wonderful. Well, Gary, we leave everyone with one last question, and that is, tell us something that you are looking forward to.
I'm looking forward to this new freshman class for sure. They're beautiful, beautiful people. And I'm looking forward to having Steven Schwartz in the fall. He's going to be our guest. He will be performing in between filming of Wicked, of course. He's an alum, by the way, and he's a good friend. I'm looking forward to our new season at school. I'm looking forward to just enjoying teaching, you know? I mean, that's my passion. I want to inspire in students, and for those even auditioning, show who you are, show your light. We all have a light, and it can be dimmed by judgment, by trying to be perfect, which is boring, by singing the wrong rap, by not by it's so important to that inner light. I can tell you that there's students that were not accepted anywhere else in any other program that we took, and you would know their names, by the way, so I'm not going to say them. But I, when I was doing the audition tour myself, saw this interesting individual that didn't fit anywhere else. That it was like, wow, what is that? And why am I excited to hear you sing? That individual light, that soul, that passion. Yes, I'm going to use the word feeling. Don't be afraid of feeling. I know in acting classes they'll say, don't, you can't play the feeling. Well, I understand that. You can't and you mustn't. But you are allowed to feel because singing is passion. Singing is vowels of long, great, great crying, laughing, all the good things that we share as human beings. And definitely be ready for breaking down that fourth wall in an audition and showing us who you are. I don't know where that came from, but I think I'm really passionate about students not doing a formula, but making sure that they are really, really ready to show who they are without fear of judgment. And that's my passion, is to teach that. And I teach that in my acting a song class. I really love teaching the students how to give them permission, just give them permission to break through the training, the blah, 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 and to be honest individuals and great human beings ready for the theater to tell stories to this ugly world.
Well, Gary, thank you so much. If students or parents want to learn any more about Carnegie Mellon, what is the best way for them to get in touch?
Well, I would say, of course, the website is quite filled with all faculty, of course, and emails. They're definitely able to talk to Micah Harrison Loosemore, our director of admissions, if they have questions about the program itself, as far as how to apply, which a lot of people are still curious about that. if you don't have that information at your high school. So yes, definitely contact us and contact the new head. I'm sure he'd be happy to hear from students that are interested in applying, and certainly they're welcome to reach out to me. Absolutely.
Well, thank you again, Gary. I'm glad we were finally able to make this podcast possible today. And we hope to see your face around here real soon at the college audition. So thanks again for joining us.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you. It's my
All
pleasure.
right. Bye-bye.
For more information on the exciting training workshops and masterclasses offered by The College Audition, please visit us online at www.thecollegeaudition.com or follow us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok.